Live streaming. Should be anyway. Takes a few seconds for it to confirm. Cool. So we're live. And we're, I guess, doing day two of a little bit of mathematics. Okay, just a drop-in session. We're gonna do four sessions today. An hour pop. Okay. And the schedule is basically, we're doing one right now, which is 9 a.m. my time. Let me just open this up. Hello, Tom. How are you doing? Welcome to our day of math, right? So we're gonna do one at 9 a.m., which is now. We're gonna do one at 11. Oh, I guess it goes into the live stream. Cool. I was just checking the events, and as soon as you go to the events, when I go live, I didn't notice about Twitch. It kicks you into the live stream. I was looking at the times when we're going to do, when I set them up. But I believe if you go to the events page, it's going to be at 11:30 a.m., 2 p.m., and 4:30 p.m. So we're going to do four sessions. Hello, hello Index. How are you doing? And Casey, how are you? You're back. Hope you're feeling better, man, from yesterday. I know you retired. Well, you tried to go to bed early, but you kept on coming back and checking out what was going on. And by the way, one thing about yesterday, when we were talking about towards the end, we did a sort of we start talking about combinatorics permutation a little. Thank you. Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. Hope you're drinking your good tea. After our session yesterday, the second session, I went and made myself some ginger Persian black tea. It's that time of year. You get nice ginger and make some ginger tea. That's fantastic if you're feeling cold or whatnot. You want to warm up a little bit. Yeah, peppermint. Peppermint's fantastic too. I threw some peppermint in there. Not peppermint, but just mint leaves that we have as well. But just in case you were here, I think it was the second stream. We're talking about combinatorics. I wish you again a good evening, Master. Good evening to you as well. Good morning from my end. It's starting out the day, Saturday weekend, doing a little bit of mathematics is, I like it, just very relaxing to a certain degree, right? So I hope people that need help do pop by, because if anybody still has exams left, I realize that I guess other parts of the world, people have already finished their exams. So it might be a little bit quiet, depending on where you are. But in my part of the world, the exams basically start in June and go almost all the way to the end of June. If we do this, well, we'll definitely do this next year as long as I'm around. If we do this next year, I'll start math drop-in sessions earlier. Okay, we'll do them maybe at the beginning of May. That way, people in other parts of the world, if they're writing their exams, especially if you're in college or university, and by that time, hopefully, I would have had time to look up calculus a lot more and get my hands dirty with statistics a little bit more. We'll start it earlier next year, okay? But if you were here yesterday, towards the end, we talked about combinatorics, and someone asked the question, where in the real world would use combinatorics, permutations, trying to figure out how many different ways you can order things and stuff like this, which really kicks into probability and statistics, right? And just out of the blue, the person said, you know, to provide an example where we would use this in the real world. And for me, I went back to something that I'm familiar with and something that I worked with a student a few days before too, but I haven't delved into it too much. And I said, well, one of the places you could use combinatorics that kicks into probability and statistics is for games of chance, specifically poker. And I've spent a long time playing poker. I played lots of games of chance, and I used to know the stats on it a lot better. So I try to go back to my memory, pull out the stats, but I made a mistake on that one, right? So I looked it up this morning just to do a little correction on what I wrote, right? And if you go to the wiki page, just do poker probability, okay? And if you scroll down, and there's a table they've set up there, and they start off with, you know, the type of hands you can get, the distinct hands, frequency probability, cumulative probability, and the odds, and all that jazz. And then on the last column, on the rightmost column, it has mathematical expression of absolute frequency. Okay, and frequency is combinatorics, how many different ways we can form something, right? And this is the frequency, this is the number of different two pair hands you can make in poker. Okay, and let me just write it down for you. It's take off my glasses and I'm going to use this view before we get into, you know, the salutations and stuff. I like to do the corrections as soon as possible. Doop. So we did this hand and it's 13. Basically it's going to be 13 choose 2, 4 choose 2, 11 choose 1, and 4 choose 1. Okay, hopefully that's coming out okay. Maybe I use a darker one for the next stuff. And oh, and this should be squared. I knew there was something I keep on forgetting on this. This is supposed to be squared. Okay, because you're picking, you're trying to match up the pair with the singles you choose. So basically the way it works is from, there's 52 cards in a deck and there's 13 cards of each suit, right? So you're gonna pick two cards from the 13, right? And from there, you have to match up those two cards to make two pairs, right? And that's why it's square. So you pick those, and then you have one card left, one spot open. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Your five card hand. This is the number of ways you can get the last card. And these guys are the number of ways you can get these two pairs, whatever they might be, right? Okay, just to clarify that up, and this is your last card. It doesn't, as long as it doesn't match one of any of these guys, which is why you have 11 here, right? So you're eliminating the two numbers, may they be numbers or face cards, whatever, right? Or the aces, right? So you're eliminating two from the 13 that you could choose from, and you only have 11 more cards left that you could pick at random to fill up the spot. You can't have the two that you chose here to be one of these choices, because that would make a full house, right? I just looked that up just to answer it for myself and remind myself, right? As we talked about one thing yesterday's stream too, use it or lose it. If you don't use this information, you tend to forget it, right? You tend to lose the ability, you lose that power, right? But the beauty of mathematics is if you know the syntax of the language of mathematics, this is just the syntax applied to the game of poker, right? This is combinatorics, and that has a specific meaning, saying 13 choose 2, which basically means 13 factorial over 13 minus 2 factorial, 2 factorial. This is the math part of it, right? That's the syntax of the language of mathematics. You can take this and apply it in the real world, and this happens to be poker. So you don't have to know how mathematics is applied in every discipline, every system, right? As long as you know the core language, the syntax of the language of mathematics, you can apply that anywhere, right? So that I wanted to clarify. It's a beautiful way to look at mathematics and really appreciate why it's important to learn math, which is really the question that the person asked yesterday. Why are we learning math, right? Come back here. Let me see the comments here. Catch up on the comments. And aside from that, welcome to another live stream. Hello, Monkey. How are you doing? I wish you again good evening. I got here perfect timing, sweet, sweet, sweetie. So again, we're gonna do, you know, I set this up. They're shorter sessions, I guess. An hour a pop, and I realize there isn't too many people doing mathematics right now. I guess people have finished up. But if there's any questions that you guys have regarding mathematics, we can do, okay, or we can talk about. almost anything else you'd like to talk about. If anything comes up that we can put in another video, maybe politics, economics, life, whatever it is, I'll get my notepad here. We can make a little note and we can tackle it later, okay? And one of the other things I should have specified regarding mathematics, these open discussions as well, which is one thing I do when I try to put my math content together, try to teach mathematics, and I look this up and I try to make it relevant to the present to a certain degree or take some historical data, is basically what I do is I look for data and I take that data and I crunch the numbers and present a certain perspective, and then from that I either end up making a video or I, you know, make a note of it, just a mental note of it, that if the opportunity comes up, I use that example to get a point across when teaching mathematics, right? So that to me is math. For me anyway, right? Aside from learning the syntax of the language. So if there's any type of data, you know, that's a long intro to it, but if there's any type of data that you would like us to take a look at, these open discussions are open to that, right? These sessions that we do with mathematics are open to that. And hopefully that'll open up a huge can of worms, right? In terms of, hey, can we do this? Can we learn this? Can we take a look at this data and maybe get a point across, and we'll do the searches together possibly. Okay, and if you do know the information where it can be found, you could probably post it on Discord. Let me do this. Aha. Play tahi. Aga. Play tahi. Tahiti online. I don't know that name. That game. Discord. Hey, how come? Oops, I made a space on it. Discord. And there's the Discord page that we've set up. And if there's any data you'd like us to take a look at, then post links in the Discord. There's a mathematics section, right? And later on, maybe we'll quit. I've been thinking about doing this, but I've been really busy until the end of the year, school year. But basically, creating another folder in Discord in regards, and basically calling it research. And this is something that I would really like to do. I know there might there's Casey and probably maybe other people here that are active on Discord as well, that we've set up for Chicho. There's different forums you can have discussions on, or we can have discussions on or post questions. I'm thinking about creating a new folder and calling it research topics or something like this. And as a community, we could take a look at certain types of data and create a math lesson, or just take a look at that data and crunch the numbers and to see what the data tells us. And hopefully I can take some of that and include it in a math lesson or an example that we can use when learning the syntax of the language of mathematics. So basically some of the stuff that I've been doing behind the scenes, but do it in a more open fashion, right? Because I do believe in Creative Commons and making all this stuff open. Hello, luxurious. Hello, luxurious. How are you doing? And by the way, since there isn't any math questions, you can post it anytime. We'll break, do math, and talk about whatever, okay? Aside from this, I was thinking about doing an update video just before this started. That sounds really interesting. Yeah, I really want to do that, Casey, because there's so much data. And one thing with what kind of math do you teach? I teach high school mathematics. I'm very focused on high school mathematics, and I have worked actually this year as well. I worked with a couple of college students with statistics and stuff like this. Quick math, I do quick math. I work with a couple of college students doing some statistics and stuff like this, but I'm mainly focused on high school math. And I've done a little bit of elementary school. Some parents that I have, that word of mouth gets out, that, and I do private, I do private and group, so, and I don't really advertise. It's just word of mouth that goes around. I've had some student, some parents contact me, either they've taught their kids when they were in high school, or they've heard that I do an okay job teaching mathematics, prepping kids for the real world, right? So there are some students that I've worked with that are in elementary school, but elementary school mathematics in my part of the world is ridiculously simple. It's absurd how easy it is, and I usually fly through that stuff. And in elementary school, I start teaching them high school mathematics. Okay, and unfortunately, in my part of the world, what's happened is math education has deteriorated dramatically, dramatically. And I keep on saying this in the streams, but I can't even overemphasize this. It is horrendous. And it blows my mind where I read statistics and saying, I'm in Canada, by the way. I read stats and reports saying Canadians do well in mathematics. Canadians, says that is an outright misinformation, disinformation. I even go as far as saying it's a lie. Okay, easiest but most important. Easy for sure. Elementary school math, easiest, extremely important. Unfortunately, they're doing a horrendous job teaching it. They're confusing the living daylights out of the kids. So kids coming into grade 8 into high school mathematics in my part of the world, most of them don't even know how to deal with fractions. Like, I'm not kidding you. They don't even know how to deal with fractions. They don't know how to move around an equal sign. They really don't have a grasp of numbers. They don't even know their multiplication table. Okay. Is so bad, so bad. And that's one of the reasons I decided, as soon as the technology was available, and what I do with technology, I try to incorporate that into my life and figure out how I can use that technology into my life to improve my life, right? To complement my life. That's basically disruptive innovation. And as soon as I realized that live streaming was going to be a way to interact, to continue my sort of passion to teach mathematics, right? I decided to do this because what that's doing is allowing me to relearn some of the stuff that I've forgotten because math curriculum in my part of the world has deteriorated to a level where they've taken out so much information that I'm not using it, so I'm losing it, right? Hello, Lexi. How are you doing? Welcome to live stream on a Saturday morning, doing a little bit of mathematics and open discussion. Would you be cool with talking about the Monty Hall problem? Oh, the Monty Hall problem. What is that problem? I know that problem. Though it's kind of basic statistics, there's a lot of interesting cognitive psychology concepts within it, in that most people don't understand the basic concept of statistics, even when a real life situation is given to them. Oh, that's the Monty problem is, oh yeah, this is the problem. That's behind the door. There's three doors. Oh man, I looked at this long time ago. Let me lay it out. Just remember what it is again, okay? So let me lay this out. Let me erase this guy. Okay, and contour, oh yeah, great problem. Contour, I'm gonna talk about it. If I make any mistakes, please post comments. As soon as I finish laying it out, I'll read your comment and then we'll do any corrections if need be. Okay, but this is the Monty Hall problem. Okay, so there is a game show, or there was actually, it's back again, I guess. I think I've seen my grandmother or someone watching it, right? It was a TV show called Let's Make a Deal. Okay, and basically people dressed up in costumes, and there was this, the presenter was actually a very lovable character. He was sort of the jester, the joker. He was sort of
he liked to throw a little bit of fuel on the fire, right? Tease people and give them, make them deals that made them think, should they take the deal or not take the deal? And usually, you know, people would dress up, and the camera person would find someone who's dressed up really crazy, and they say, "Oh, you know, the gingerbread man or something, let's make a deal." And the presenter would go up to these people dressed up in a costume, and they would be basically, if I remember the game correctly, there's three doors, okay, or three curtains. Okay, let me read the questions, make sure I'm laying this down properly. Deal or no deal, deal or no deal kind of deal, kind of game show for sure, right? So there's door number one, door number two, and door number three. Okay. And man, I'm trying to, while I'm explaining this, I'm trying to remember the logic behind the mathematics, and hopefully it'll come to me. Okay. But basically, here's the presenter. I draw good stick figures, right? Here's the gingerbread man. Here's the gingerbread man. Dressed up as a gingerbread man. Here's the guy's mic, right? So this Monty guy comes along, big smile. He plays sort of what do you call it? Anyway, he tries to make it entertaining, right? So he comes up to the gingerbread man and says, "Listen, sometimes I guess it worked this way, where the guy has money, right? Let's say he's got like $500, the five fingers for $500." And the presenter says, "I'll give you $500 right now. You sit down, we'll go find someone else that's dressed nicely, and we can make a deal." I think, I remember, I watched this when I was a kid a little bit. "Or you can not take the $500 and decide on opening one of these curtains, and the gingerbread man would get one of the prizes in one of the curtains," right? And very seldom people took the $500 or whatever it is that he was offering. Sometimes it was $50, maybe $100 or something, right? The devil's advocate. Yes, that's the word. Thank you, comment. I'm checking the comments. So he would play the devil's advocate, right? And he did a fantastic job, right, doing it. So this person, you know, there'd be people in the audience, and this is in the audience, so you see a whole bunch of people dressed in all kinds of wacko kind of ways, right? You got a whole bunch of people in the background dressed in crazy ways, cheering, yelling, you know, waving high at the camera and stuff like this, right? So it's a fun, entertaining game. So this guy would say, "No, I don't want the money. I want to pick a door," right? And people all of a sudden would start yelling and screaming, "Pick door number one, two, three, pick one of those doors," right? So let's say the guy picked door number one, right? So the person picks door number one, and in door number one, sometimes it would be a fantastic prize, right? So I don't, it was sort of on the low end. The game was a sort of on the cheap end of the gaming stuff. So there wasn't like a Porsche or anything behind here. Sometimes it was a video game, like a pinball game, pinball machine, right? Sometimes it was something else, right? And by the way, I'm just remembering, he would say, this guy would say, "I pick door number one," and then Monty would say, "Yeah, that's right, that's the way it worked." So he would say, this guy would say, "I pick door number one." So here's his little door bubble, or here's his little speech bubble, right? Let's do a little speech bubble here. Here's his speech bubble. He would say, "Door number one," right? And Monty would go, "You pick door number one, eh? I think he would offer more money for the guy to change his mind," or something like this, or something along that level, right? And then door number one would open up. I think there was a little bit more intricate stuff associated with it, right? And then sometimes there would be, that's one thing they loved having. They would loved having a goat. I don't even know how to draw a goat. That doesn't look like a goat, but let's assume it was a goat. Okay, I'm gonna read the comments because I think I'm missing some kind of interaction here with the game. Hold on a second. Let me change the camera angle. I wish this question was coming up. I would have read up on it, right? Let's check it out. Typically, there was no new car. There was behind the curtain and two goats. Ah, yeah, two goats. So I drew one goat. People expected the probability of winning to be 50-50 after choosing one incorrect door, and they would show a curtain they didn't pick and give them the option to switch. Oh, okay, I gotta read this up then. I remember it incorrectly. This is a long time ago that I looked at this. So they would show them door number one. Okay, I'm gonna look this up, the Monty problem. Sorry, gang. Monty problem. Monty Hall problem. Here we go. And give them the option to switch. So they would say, oh, I gotta remember this. I can't remember it now. Thanks for trying to draw pointer hints to me, Contour, but I forget the little intricate part about it, I guess. The Monty Hall problem is a brain teaser, so I'm just gonna read the wiki page for the Monty Hall problem, right? The Monty Hall problem is a brain teaser in the form of a probability puzzle. Losing based on the American television game, loosely based on the American television game show Let's Make a Deal, and made the pa 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 1970. It became famous after a question from a reader's letter quoted in Marilyn Vaughn, whatever, Ask Marilyn column in Parade magazine in 1990. So it became famous in 1990. Suppose you're on a game show and you're given the choice of three doors. Behind one door is a car, behind the others goats. You pick a door, say number one, okay, and the host, oh, that's right, they don't show the door that they picked. They show one of the other doors. Who knows what's behind? Doors open. Another door says three, which is a goat. He then says, do you want to pick door number two? Is it to your advantage to switch your vote? Others that who switch have a, oops, two-thirds chance of winning the car, while contestants who stick to their initial choice have this. Okay, so that's right, they don't show them the door that they picked. Let me read the comments and give them a switch. It's important that you phrase this problem correctly. Yeah, I wasn't phrasing it correctly, right? It's pretty simple. You have three doors and one of them has the prize. You pick one, and on the other two is shown to have nothing. You're offered to switch, and you should, because you will win 60%. Yeah, that's right. The mathematics is straightforward, but the wording of the problem is the important part. Chance after wrong, that's why it's kind of a brain teaser, because with the given chance of switching. Okay, cool. So let's do this. So the guy, check this out. So Monty comes wrong. Oh, I gotta switch the camera angle. My bad. Did this last week. You did this yesterday. So the guy says, here's door number one, right? So the guy says, I picked door number one. And Monty, being a devil's advocate, says, oh, you picked door number one, eh? And then he turns to the audience and says, before we open up door number one and seal this deal, let's show Mr. Gingerbread Man what's behind door number three. So they show door number three, and sometimes it's a goat, sometimes it's something else. They say, you know, it's a pinball machine, right? I think anyway, sometimes it's a pinball machine. And they say, you know, instead of opening number one, you can take the pinball machine, right? And the guy says, no, I want to see behind door number one. And then the Monty says, well, I'll give you one more choice. You can switch your choice from number one to number two, okay? Because maybe at the beginning they've told them there's something, you know, behind one of these is a goat, behind one of these is something better than a pinball machine or something, right? He says, I'll give you a chance to switch your vote, right? Instead of door number one, you can pick door number two. And most people would say that because you're down to two choices, then you have a 50-50% odd of winning the better prize, right? However, the way this works is because initially your choice was one out of three, that means if you pick door number one, it was one third of a chance of you being correct. And if you, and the, if the good prize was behind door number two or number three, this was two thirds of a chance of being correct, right? Just because they showed this to you, it doesn't remove the possibility that there's a two thirds probability of the better prize, not the goat, being behind door number two than it is behind door number one, right? And this is called conditional probability, I believe, in mathematics, where we already know the condition or one of the conditions popped up, so the probability changes to a certain degree. Sometimes it stays the same, sometimes it changes if we know the conditions have changed, right? So that's as far as I can go with this without really delving into it and creating a full-blown lesson and bringing different examples into this to get this point across. But it is a fun exercise. I wish I remembered the question more more accurately instead of having to read it, right? Let's check it out. Yeah, but most people think there's a 50-50 chance after a wrong one being revealed. That's why it's kind of a brain teaser, because of the misunderstanding. With the given chance of switching, yeah, it's conditional probability. Yeah, it's conditional probability. It's really cool, actually, conditional probability and stuff like this. There's different formulas that you can use. It's, you know, the basically the syntax for it is something like this. And you have to, sort of appreciate the trick with doing mathematics, with doing word problems, with doing probability, combinatorics, and stuff like this. As a race killer mentioned, okay, and hi race killer, how are you doing? You're back again for another day of math. It's important that you phrase the problem correctly. So one word in a word problem can mean the difference between using this type of formula to solve it or this type of formula to solve it. It changes the game, which is one of the reasons why a lot of people have a hard time with word problems in mathematics. I, for me as well, you know, words sometimes confuse me to a certain degree. Sometimes I read things backwards. Sometimes I, you know, read a word that's not there. Sometimes I'm reading fast and I skip an and or an or, and those are the words ands and ors and ifs in mathematics. When you're trying to quantify a problem, those are the words that really matter. Okay, the gingerbread man doesn't matter, right? Monty doesn't matter. What matters is the connecting words from one thought to another, because those are the things that in mathematics that pop out at you, right? So conditional probability, sometimes you have just the syntax on it is, I can't remember it, but I'll try. You know what, I'll just do the base on it. Sometimes you do, if you want to write down what's the probability of flipping a coin, right? If you're flipping a coin, right, you can get heads or tails, right? So the probability of flipping a coin once, the probability of getting a head is 50%, 0.5, right? But sometimes when you write, when you want to find the probability of something, probability of A given that B has occurred, all of a sudden this, I believe, becomes the probability of A and B divided by the probability of B or something like this. I'm probably getting this wrong, but the whole there's a whole formula depending on what the condition was that they gave you, right? And again, as long as you know the syntax, what each part of this means, then you can
do the mathematics based on the problem as long as you understand what the problem is referring to, right? It's I'm sort of being wishy-washy about this, but the reason is because this thing changes depending on what type of systems we're looking at, right? It's pretty cool, actually. Very cool. The reason people misunderstand this is because people don't explain it correctly. That's what my professor said. He kept telling us the English translations into math is the most important. 100%. 100%. A lot of people explain it in a way that 50% is correct. Yeah, yeah. They don't explain that there's conditions to it, right? There's like the mathematics. Well, as soon as you quantify something in the real world, you can't be wishy-washy with things. That's the beauty of mathematics. When, you know, that's why mathematicians, I may be very, very much over generalizing this thing, but that's why people who speak the language of mathematics, who really appreciate what mathematics and is using math in the real world, they can't really become politicians because they can't really be wishy-washy. They're really straight up direct. That's my experience anyway, in large part, and I'm really generalizing here, so my apologies, but I do tend to generalize a lot. I've actually had students where, you know, work with students where they're getting, you know, they're in 80-90%, you know, that's their marks that they're getting in math, right? When it comes to doing the syntax and doing problems that they understand and appreciate. But then when it comes to certain sections where they're taking English and trying to trick them, right? And they read these problems, they end up failing those exams, and they're like, oh, they get totally destroyed and emotionally, you know, up and down. It's a roller coaster ride, and they're like, oh man, I'm really bad in math, and da 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 da. And I explain to them, look man, it's not your mathematics that's the problem, it's the English that's the problem. So if English happens to be their second language, I just tell them, don't worry about it, just improve your English slowly, you'll get these problems. If their natural language is English, then I have a talk with them and with their parents and say, listen, your kid is good at mathematics, okay? You should take some of that energy that they're putting into the sciences and focus on learning the language that they're communicating in, because English is going to prevent them from progressing in certain fields if they want to, even if it's math related, even if it's science related. Okay, sorry about mucking up the Monty problem a little bit. I got really excited about it. I was like, oh, Monty problem, I've seen this for a long time. Super important difference to race killer. Racer kill. Oh, yeah, I read that incorrectly, did I? Racer. Oh, it's race. It's not race killer, it's racer kill. Professor. Brimstone, racer kill. I don't know what racer kill refers to. Yeah, race killer, I guess that wouldn't be a nice thing to say, right? You know how to do quad formula? Yeah, the quadratic formula for sure. X is, it's the only formula I remembered after high school. Dante, how are you doing? Hello. The quadratic formula is one of the few formulas that I remembered retained after graduating from high school and university. It just rolls off the tongue, right? X is equal to negative b plus or minus square root of b squared minus 4ac over 2a, right? Never forget that formula. We end up in the sciences, we end up using it a lot, right? That's why you remember it. You tend to retain it. I've forgotten. I think there was time in my life that I forgot what the area of a circle was, but I still remembered the quadratic formula, right? Because we ended up using a lot. And the quadratic formula is just one piece of the puzzle, one part of the puzzle, where the way they teach it to you, when they say it's used to find the x-intercepts, where it comes into play. There's a huge, this is actually a really cool channel now. Thanks, brother. I'm glad it's turning to be a real cool challenge now. My favorite formula is PV equals NRT. PV equals NRT, NRT. Oh my God, from chemistry. I've used that and I can't remember what it is. PV equals NRT. T must refer to the temperature in Kelvin, most likely. R is resistance. Voltage? PV is voltage? I can't remember that. When I used to tutor for mathematics, when I was taking calculus back in the day, teaching students to translate sentences into formulas, formula logic symbols, and teaching them basic logic rules like module pons showed them how to translate word problems in mathematics to filter useful information and logically reach conclusions. Oh, okay. I've just gone with experience when I teach it to my students. I go, oh, what does of mean in mathematics? And I do, because I'm mainly focused on high school math. But that's cool. I'll keep this in mind, actually. As you can tell, my English isn't very powerful. It's just powerful enough for me to do what I need to do. Okay. And I didn't, as far as English, this one on the pressure, volume, and temperature. That's right. Pressure, volume, and temperature. Cool. V is volume. P is pressure. Okay. Cool. I totally forgot about that stuff. Man, I miss chemistry. I love chemistry. But just to let you know, just since we're on the topic of English, okay, I think momentum was always my favorite formula. Momentum, I really like because it was so easy. Yeah, P equals MV and conservation of momentum, right? And before you introduce friction and heat loss and distortion into it, of course, right? But when it comes to English, my English was horrendous. Coming out of high school, it was horrendous. Coming out of university, it was horrendous. When I got my first job as a geophysicist, it was horrendous. Okay, I mentioned this before, but I remember doing my first geophysics project by myself and writing a report. So I would, someone else at that time, I wasn't writing proposals, so the job came to us. And when I went out and collected the data, I was very good at collecting data, processing data. I was good at the mathematics aspect of it, so I got the stuff. I was good in the graphic design and made the maps and stuff like this. So I put all the diagrams together and I wrote my report and I gave it to my higher up to review, my mentor, really. Within an hour, he came back and he threw the report on my desk and said, "What the hell is this?" I went, "What?" And I picked it up, and I had never ever submitted in an essay or a report or anything in high school or university that had so much red all over it. Every page was crossed out and written. It took me from here, because I was very proud of writing my first report and handing it in, to down here where I was like, man, I am out of my league, right? So that's where my English was when I got my first job as a geophysicist. And over the years, I got better and better. And about 10 years ago, when I started blogging, I took about 2, 3 years dedicated into learning how to write and improve my English. Really, really important. What is the most complicated equation you can show us? You know what? The most complicated stuff is Maxwell's equations. Okay. Maxwell's equations, I looked into this a long time ago. I was looking into the works of Tesla. Okay. And who was the person? I was watching lectures from, I forget the guy's name, so I'm not gonna mention any names. But if you do Tesla, there's a couple of guys online. They're old school. They've done a lot of work on Tesla, on electromagnetics, magnetic methods. Like for me, I got my degree in geophysics with a minor in mathematics, and I specialized in electromagnetic and magnetic methods. Okay, that's what I specialized in. I even had one of my thesis for my bachelor's thesis. For my bad, no, not Tesla car, the real Tesla, Nikola Tesla, right? My bachelor's thesis was even accepted in SAGEEP, and that was that's the largest geophysics conference, and it's held, I believe, in California. I was invited in to do a presentation. I was like just out of university, like crazy, out of my league, right? But I specialize in electromagnetic methods, right? And all the electromagnetic magnetic formulas and stuff we learned all the way through university, all the way through my geophysics career, that was using these equations, they were all the shortened versions of what really those equations were. I found that out when I looked into Nikola Tesla and read some articles and watched a whole bunch of lectures, right? At some point, I would like to go back and relearn all that stuff with the full equations, because they were basically truncated equations, if I remember correctly. That stuff will take your head for a spin, and I think there's a lot of information there to be had. Okay. Can you show us? I can't show you. I haven't looked into this stuff a long time ago. I wish I could show you right now. And at some point we will go into it. I promise you that. But that's going to be a while down the road. My apologies. I would have to do a review. I would have to do it justice. I don't want to do another Monty problem where I started off and I forgot the little details and the wording. As Racer Kill mentioned, the wording of the problem, it was Racer Kill, the wording of the problem, the way you present the information is very, very important when trying to get math concepts across. So some things, that's the reason I'm not really tackling calculus and hardcore probability statistics yet, because I really want to make sure I'm correct in the words that I use, right? And I'm going down the right pathways. Okay. Are you a French speaker? I'm not. I speak the only language I can read and write in is English. Okay. I'm fluent in English. Okay in English, I guess. I can communicate well in English. Well enough, at least anyway. And I also speak Farsi, Persian, and Armenian. Okay, and I speak the language of mathematics, and I can hold my own on a poker table and on the craps table, because that's a different language itself. That's a different language itself. Were you struggling with English because you weren't speaking at home? Yeah, for sure. My first language, national language, is Armenian. I learned Farsi. When I came to Canada, I didn't speak a word of English. Can you? No, I can't read. I used to be able to read a little bit, but I never learned, and I was trying to learn when I'm teenage years, but there was too much going on during the teenage years. Okay. Because we weren't speaking. Da, 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 da. One thing I'll let you know about English, my experience with English. Man, not man. Gucci. I'll give you a story about me in English. Okay, so when I went to, let me erase this stuff here just in case we start something else. So when I came to Canada, I didn't speak a word of English. I used to think, "How are you?" meant hello. Okay, so I'll go around and say, "How are you? How are you?" It's hilarious, really. And I was sort of a trickster to a certain degree. So I like having fun. Didn't really, nothing, things didn't faze me too much, and if they did, I dealt with it. So I was learning English, and I was only 10 years old when I came, right? So halfway through grade 5, so I was learning English in grade 5, 6, 7. So by the time I finished grade 7, I could talk with people, but my writing, reading was horrendous, right? My level of English was really low. And then I went to high school. And in high school, they told us we had to take a second language, and the second language that was offered during the time when I was in high school was French only, right? So I was struggling with English. I'm still trying to learn English. My mathematics was super powerful, right? The mathematics in Iran that they taught you in Iran in grade 5 was equivalent to the mathematics that they were teaching in Canada in grade 10.
Okay. So what I remember when I arrived in Canada, I went to math class in grade 5 and I sat down and they were doing math and I didn't remember. This is like first couple of weeks being here. I didn't speak English. I didn't know what people were saying, but I knew what they were writing on the wall, on the chalkboard, the teacher writing mathematics, and he was writing 3 plus 2 equals 5. Like, I was like, what's going on, right? They were writing just like numbers being added and subtracted. 7 minus -3 equals 10. I was sitting there looking around, going, this is weird. Like, what's going on? Like, I had done that in grade like 2. The mathematics I was doing in grade 5 in Iran was functions. So there was a huge gap. And there is right now too. The mathematics, like in grade 8 in Iran, right? I had a family member in grade 8 in Iran that they had started doing calculus, right? Back then, at the end of the 70s, right? That's when we came to Canada, right? End of the 70s, in Canada, you couldn't find a high school in Canada that taught calculus in grade 12, let alone grade 8. Right, so there was a huge gap there. So my math was powerful, but my English was horrendous when I went to high school, right? And when I went to high school, they said, okay, you need a second language, you have to take French. And I told them, listen, I'm barely know English, like, you know, I can communicate, I can talk, but I don't, my essay writing, my spelling, all this stuff is bad. So learning another language now is going to be extremely difficult. And they said, no, it's just they use the same letters. I'm like, no, like I know two other languages. And at the time when I came, I knew how to read and write Farsi. I've forgotten now. And I knew a little bit of Armenian reading. And I said, well, why can't I learn Farsi or Armenian? And they turned to me, they said something to a high school student, to a teenager that you, no administration, no teacher should ever say. Okay. They turned to me and they said, we don't recognize those languages, right? And me being Chicho, I am who I am, right? My name, whatever it might be, this is me that you see, right? And this is me that you see when I was in grade 8, the core philosophy. I've changed my mindset on many, many things about how society, the world works and stuff like this. But my demeanor is a way that I confront authority, right? And they turned to me and they said, administration. Yeah, rude. Yeah, 100%. They don't recognize. So I turned to them and I said, well, I don't recognize your language, right? I don't recognize French. So I took French from grade 8 to grade 11 in high school. Okay. I learned some of the basics, fenêtre, right, window, whatever. But in grade 9, I in school, what I did was I learned what I wanted to learn, and anything that was rammed down my throat that I didn't want to learn, I cheated. And I in grade 9, I had a cheating method in high school that was basically foolproof, almost, right? I never got caught. And one day I'll show it to you. Okay. So in grade 9 or grade 8, probably, I started creating this cheat thing that I had that would come with me. Okay. And basically, from grade 8 all the way to grade 11, for French, I cheated. And I didn't refuse to learn that language. I learned the basics just to get along. And I ended up getting like, I don't know, 80% in it. That's how ridiculous high school education is, right? You can learn nothing and still get a good mark. Okay. Put minimal effort and still get a good mark. That's why I always get surprised when I explain this to my students, saying, listen, high school is not hard. The amount of work you have to put in university if you want to really do it right, 1 month of high university work, if you're doing it right, if you're getting the most out of your money, because it's your dime, right? Your time, right? That's the way it should be. If you're studying something, put your full attention on it. You know, the amount of work you do in 1 month or 2 months of university is probably equivalent to all of high school math, right? Or at least one semester if you do it correctly.
One semester I took four math courses at university. Two of them I didn't even have the prerequisites for. They were applied mathematics. It was high level math. It was insane, right? I had no right to take those courses, but I did, and I did okay, and I passed them, and I relearned what I. So if you do it hardcore in university, 4 months of university should be equivalent to all of high school, right? So that's my story about learning English and French. Okay. Going off topic of mathematics, but as I've said before, I'll share as much as I can to help share my experience and help any of you guys that are struggling through university or high school or whatever it might be. Man, get through it. Life awaits you at the end of the door, right? Okay, that's super shitty on administration. Cool. So we're about an hour. How about we call this the session, the first session. We've got three more sessions coming up. The next one's 11:30. And what I'm gonna do right now. Oh, Casey's messages. I've never let's read this Casey's comment. I had a similar experience being forced to take German. Luckily, the teacher was very reasonable, and she left me a few other. Let me and a few other people just doodle and chat as long as we didn't disrupt. Oh, that's fantastic. Lucky. I didn't have that experience with French anyway. I had some amazing teachers. I got along with almost everyone. I didn't. There was a handful of people in my life that have come across certain demeanor that we have conflict with, but in general, I'm okay with most people. There are certain type though that we do bang heads. It is what it is, right? It is what it is. But one thing I wanted to let you know before we end this session, before we come on with the next session, I edited the how to take notes video. Okay. And as soon as we end this session, I'm gonna let it loose on YouTube. Okay. It took me a long time to edit it. My desktop computer is officially needs a serious upgrade. So it kept on crashing. It took me 3 days to edit it. So I didn't get to the cryptocurrency one. The cryptocurrency one I'm gonna get to in 2 weeks, because for the next 2 weeks my students are in exams. I have to spend a lot of time with them and stuff, and have a lot of other things going on. Okay, so I won't get a chance to edit the cryptocurrency video. That'll come up in 2 weeks most likely, but I'm gonna let loose the how to take notes video. It took me a day to edit it, a day to debug, to figure out a way, an around way to be able to process it. And then it took me another day to muck around with it and process, and I let it process, and it took 15 hours to render. Okay. It's only an hour long, but because I have videos popping up when I'm showing notes, because what I do in that video, we went through my notebook. Behind the scenes, we did it and we showed it. We went through my notebook, some of the notes that I've taken over the years, over the last few years anyway. I went through like six of the notebooks. I have more. And every time we hit certain type of note that I've created content, not every time, but some of the times created content, I had a video popping up. So you can see the notes that I took for that video being created. So for anyone that's into creating content, who asks me how I create content and what I do and all this jazz, that this video being loaded on right now on YouTube, it should give you an insight into what I do to a certain degree. And again, this is it is very personal, just to let you know. Okay, it is very personal the way I organize, I play with things. But as I said before, I am who I am now. I was who I was in grade 8, right? I am Chicho, right? So things really don't faze me. I don't I'm okay sharing personal information as long as it helps other people to experience life in a better way, right? And get an idea of how other people operate, because I know our education system does not do that, right? So that video is going to be loaded on, and just because we're loading that on today, I'm gonna let that float for a couple of days on YouTube, just be the main video today, tomorrow, probably Monday as well. And then I'm gonna start loading on all of these open discussion mass stuff that we're doing to YouTube. And the odds are I'm gonna load on one session at a time. Okay. And sometimes Twitch is cutting the streams. And if Twitch is cutting the streams, you know, they're becoming two sessions, two videos that are going to be loaded on. That happened with the second stream yesterday that we did, right? So today is going to be the video being loaded on YouTube, the how to take notes. And then we're going to come back at 11:30 and do another live stream. And another, we're going to come back at 2 o'clock, do another one. And then 4:30, do another one. I believe those are the times if you want to check the events page, okay? So that's it. I'll see you guys at, I believe, 11:30 for the next stream. Thank you for being here, by the way. Thank you for the questions. And thank you for the Monty question and the corrections and all that jazz. Thank you for having my back. I'll see you guys in about an hour and a half. Bye for now.